Welcome to Innovation Oxford. I'm your host, Mike Harding. Time was when you wanted to eat fish. You dropped a net in the water, and you put it in your little rowboat, rowed back home, cooked it up, and that was it. A couple thousand years ago, the Egyptians were early fish farmers, and the pharaohs ate a particular kind of fish called tilapia. Well, tilapia has arrived here in Oxford County. Today, we're just west of Tilsonburg to learn how tilapia is being raised at a fish farm, but not just any fish farm. Come, let's meet Ewart McLaughlin, who is going to take us on a tour. Good to meet you. Yeah, fish is now in your family.
That's for sure.
How big a plant is this?
Well, it's about 70,000 square feet, and there's about four large tunnels with 60,000 gallons in each one, plus several other tanks. So it's been converted from a compost facility, and we thought it was a great use for the property, and we're out here in the bush basically, and lots of farmland to raise our fish. So
come, take us on a tour. Let's go.
So what we're doing right now is pumping them up, okay? Pumping the fish. This is the fish pump. It's pumping from the tank, so there's probably 60% of the fish going to hit that mark. So what happens, it's being pumped out of the water, goes over the grid. We'll go up and take a closer look. It's going to go over the grid. The smaller fish will drop down, go back to another tank to be fed off. The bigger ones that are harvested will drop through this pipe going down through, and it's counted. That's a fish counter, so we'll know, hey, we got 3,000 fish in this particular tank that's going out at a pound and a half. We have 4,500 pounds of fish.
Let's go take a look.
For sure, let's do it.
So this is pumping the fish.
Yeah, it's pulling the fish from one of those cells, and it's pulling the fish up, and that's brought up right through the water and lifted up here, and this is where they're separated.
They're sizing it.
So the market fish we're harvesting, you watch, there's a big one that goes right across the top and right out and goes into the purge area. The smaller fish drop down through. It's just like a screening plan, or it's basically sizing the fish. So the ones that aren't quite big enough go back and are fed for another couple of months or maybe a month, and then they come up through their journey and they'll be bigger and be marketed out.
Now, is this stressful for the fish?
No, because it's just like they're swimming down a river or whatever. There's no damage to the fish through the fish pump, and they're always in the water except for this short little time they're here, and they just slide right through and they're dropped into water that's cooler. So they're coming out of 84, 85 degree wet water, and it goes sliding across the pipe. They go into the next room to be purged for 4 days, and the water temperature then drops to about 72 degrees. So that just slows their whole metabolism down.
Now,
so
purging means what?
Just to get rid of the existing feed in their body, and just to give them time to relax and just wait for till when they're shipped to Toronto, and they're shipped again live. There's oxygen put into their totes, they're shipped live to Toronto, and then they're put in aquariums and are pulled out of the grocery store. The purchaser says, I want this fish here. He likes the color, he may like the size, and then the store basically fillets it for, not really fillets it, because they cook them that way in their woks. It's a real Asian custom. So they'll take their fish, put it in a wok for a few minutes, and they have their different spices. It's all steamed. They lay it on the plate, and we personally went down to a restaurant that our buyer owns or partner in, and it's wonderful. They have the spicing and everything, and then you take it off the fish, like you eat the fish. It's on a big plate. Peel back the skin. There's no bones. The bones come off, and that's how they eat. They have some fish, maybe some pork, chicken. So that's why it all works really good for our market in Toronto. That's where most of the fish go.
It takes a lot of water here in this fish plant. What do you do with the water?
Well, it's exactly what you see. It's being recycled. It goes down the drain. It comes back up here. And this is the drum filter, and this is what takes the fish manure or feces out of the water, and it just keeps recycling. Then it goes across into what we call the biofilter, where the ammonia is taken out. So that's on the next stage, and it's full of little beads, and it's an actual bacteria that grows. And that keeps the water fresh as well. So the only water we lose is into the air. Like we lose some there, 2 or 3%, and we also lose a little bit when the drum filter comes on to flush out the water to goes to the back of the farm, which is then really not wasted. We have a hay farm back there. There's 80 some acres. And we use that water to create, to grow our hay. So it just goes in a circle.
So these are the little balls.
Yeah, the little one that attaches the bacteria. It changes this ammonia into nitrates and into nitrogen and becomes, it speeds up nature, I guess. I think that was the word you used.
Yeah, you're just speeding up what's normally done.
To finish the cycle, this is the oxygenators, and that puts the oxygen back into the water. So it just keeps going around and around. And
wait a minute, oxygen, do you make your own oxygen?
We make our own oxygen here. We originally started by buying liquid oxygen, putting it through the lines, but we found that because we're going to be in this for the long term, we bought the, it's a capital cost, but we bought the actual oxygenators. We have four out there, one for a spare. As I said before, everything's got backups. And we create our own oxygen. We take it out of the air and then expel back the excess nitrogen and everything else. And we take the oxygen, put back into the system to keep the fish going. And the biggest time to use oxygen is this biofilter uses oxygen. And the fish itself, it use it, of course, and the more they feed, the more oxygen they use.
Yeah, right.
These pumps are pumping the water in, and this is basically driving the oxygen. And these little green lines, right? So these little lines, that's your oxygen coming from the oxygenators, which is piped all over, and that's drove in to the water system here in little wee fine bubbles, and that's what gives you the most oxygen absorption. Is the finer the bubble, bang, it goes in, and like I say, then it's pumped in, does the circle, back out, up and into the tank. So this feed is very high in protein, like it's a 44 or 42% protein, and very high in fat, because the feed conversions are the greatest thing for to take a cereal, put into a meat protein. It's 1 to 1.2% times. So for every pound to pound 0.2, you get a pound of fish.
Really?
So, yes. So any of when they're smaller, it's even more than that. So what we do, and this again is to make it more feasible, the cheapest way to do it instead of small bags. When we first started here, we had to carry tons of feed up. They're eating about a ton and a half of feed a day here now.
Right.
So now we have three different feed sizes. This is all automatic. It's all computerized. So every day that you feed these fish, we know that that fish in that tank grew so many grams. So that means the next day they feed them just a little more. The fish takes in about 10% of its own weight each day in feed. So this is a great labor savings. And the guys can spend more time, because we have 8 full-time people here, they can spend more time harvesting fish, doing fish like they grade them upstairs, smaller ones to bigger ones, changing tanks, than carrying bags. So they love it too.
But it also creates predictability. If that relationship between feed and poundage of a fish creates, you can know at a certain date when
every,
you're gonna...
Yes, and every day they're fed 20 hours a day. So every 2 hours, these go off, the fish get fed, they're blown up there, there's a circle, and they know. Once that thing starts spinning, and we'll get to that later, you see that feeder start spinning, they're on top of the water ready. So it doesn't take them long to get educated on how they get fed.
What are we seeing here?
Well, what you're looking at is the fish are being harvested. So those bigger fish that you've seen coming over the top, now they're coming down this little river I was telling you about, and this is a creek. Down it comes, and then they come to the end and drop back into the lake, basically. And this is where the cooler water is, and this is where they're held. If you can take a look down in the tank there, you can see them being held, and these, they're pound and a half, pound three-quarter fish, until they're harvested and go into the totes over there and on their trip to Toronto.
Now, I noticed two different colors here. You've got dark and light.
Yeah, and some people, the taste is all the same. We have found, though, that the black fish, although they're the same mother and the same father, the black fish seem to grow faster. But we sell them, and it just depends on what color you want. Now, the Asian market, they like red colors, and we're actually breeding a red one upstairs. You'll see that.
Really?
You'll see the red, more red in them. So we're very pleased. Right now, it's about 50-50, the whites and the black fish.
How long are they going to stay here?
They'll be here 4 to 6 days, just depending on when they want them. we're pulling out, and depends on the tank. But roughly somewhere between 4 and 6 days, and then they're shipped.
Is there a buyer for every fish that's in this tank?
Right now there is, yes. So as long as we keep working with the market and don't get ahead of ourselves with too many fish, but that's a big part of it. We're working with Beaver Fisheries, and they are a wholesaler in Toronto that deliver. And so far we've had a great relationship because it was a little slower on the front end than we thought to get going. But now we're finally to that point, and we got the fish the right size. So last week we shipped about 12,000 pounds, and that's coming close to where we want to be. And going forward, we want to get up to around the 20,000 pounds a week.
Okay, so now we got a lot of fish. So they don't like being out of water. So we've got, this is the one you consider black. And in the middle there is the one. Yeah.
So these are market weight.
Market weight is about a pound and a half.
Yeah. 3/4, yeah.
I gather Sand Plains started with more than just you.
Oh yes, it's myself and my two brothers, Ed and Murray, and a whole, well, even the government got involved in this a bit, the Sand Plains people who helped in funding, lent us money, the Oceans and Fisheries helped with a grant, and with all those things, and we had the opportunity here at the farm, we changed this over to a fish farm, but the biggest asset we have is the people here running the fish farm and the people that build it. We have a great set of electricians and tradesmen, and we've worked 14 months, but that is the biggest asset we have. You hear this all the time, but this is the case.
How much did this plant cost you from dime one to today?
Well, we're probably, you know, just a little south of $10 million right now.
You got $10 million at stake. This has got to be the world's biggest fish tank. Well, not really the world. It's a 60,000-gallon fish tank, and the tilapia are all getting an eye at me. Hello. Anyway, we're going to be right back at Sand Plains Aquaculture in just a few minutes. Stay tuned. How do you deal with market? Where does it end up and why?
Well, that was one of the prerequisites, of course, when we started. We weren't going to grow these fish without a market. So we met with Andy Ipp down at the Beaver Fisheries, and he said, hey, if you guys can grow in Ontario, it's so close to our markets. You know, he would work with us and start, you know, basically buying the fish that we produced, and his market is around 15 to 20,000 pounds a week, and that was just about the size we were building. And it's, and like I said, it's worked out very well because there's about a 3 million pound market, live market of tilapia in Toronto, they say. I don't know, but so we're looking at filling maybe as much as half of that or a third of it.
And where do the fish go? Is there a particular market they go to?
Well, just several grocery stores. They're grocery stores, small grocery stores, some restaurants, but mainly they go to a grocery store, they're put in the tank, and they pick out the fish they'd like to have for supper, and you can't get any fresher. It's swimming in the tank, and from here it goes down there, it lands in the tank lots of times that afternoon, probably bought that afternoon lots of times because they ship 2-3 times a week.
Yeah.
Once we get really rolling, it'd be maybe daily.
Yeah.
So they take it down, it's sold out, and it's somebody's dinner at night. So.
You see, that's what the Asians have brought.
Yeah.
You go to China, everything that's sold there is fresh, at least at their big markets. The same in Tokyo, it's all live, everything is live, and so that's what's brought to our marketplace. You're very dependent upon a continuous electrical supply that could, if it goes down, damage your ability to take care of the fish. What do you do about it?
Well, I guess the big thing is we have backups to backups. So here, you're going to see down, you're going to see four electric generators, and then the heat is taken off those generators to heat the water. But you see the four of them running now. We're at capacity, they're running probably 70% right today, and then we're installing a new one. But then when that goes down and the grid's not available, if everything fails, you see that giant generator, that's 500 and some kVA, and I'm not familiar with all the electrical terms, but that's our final backup, and that's diesel. So we have gas, electric grid, and we have diesel power if everything else fails. So we only have about 15 minutes, and with this artificial environment, these fish have got everything perfect, and once that oxygen quits running into there, we got problems.
They're not happy anymore.
They're not happy. And our electrical guys, Ken Edwards was headed that up. He did a wonderful job. Like, it's beyond what he's come up with here. Like I say, this is state-of-the-art stuff, probably the nicest facility in the whole world. And I mean, he was a big part of that. We have the engineers come and look at it, and they go, wow. And that was done right here in Oxford County.
Yeah, with trades that we know and love. What are we gonna see here?
Well, this is our nursery, and right behind us here, wherever you got to, this is Sean Pressy. Now, he's farm manager.
The farm, you call this a farm?
Yes, this is a fish farm. So Sean is the manager and looks after it all. Now, I talk about all this stuff, but he really knows his stuff. So this particular tanks to the right are red tilapia. I was telling you about you earlier.
So Sean,
tell
us why you're bringing tilapia in this tank.
Well, these are basically future broodstock. So right now we're developing a broodstock selection program. And of course, it's going to be based on trying to select fish that are red in color. So we've already had a good start here. And we're going to continue it on. And we do a lot of our breeding right in-house here, just on the other side of the hatchery.
Sean, what are we looking at here?
This is a tank of broodstock fish. These are all males.
Yeah.
And we know that because we've gone through them and basically sexed them. And the other thing that we do is each one of these fish has a microchip embedded in it. So then each fish can be identified by that microchip. So when you're doing selective breeding, you could be able to track which female and which male have mated. And then basically from that, you can, if you want to do any selection further than that, then at least you have some lineage to go back on.
So if I'm one of the daddy fish here and I don't do a good job,
you're out.
And so the fathers are here and the mommies are over there. When do you put them together?
Basically, we want to keep all these. We have aquariums that we use for breeding.
Oh, it's like one-on-one.
It's like one-on-one, yeah.
Over there. So you have aquariums.
Basically, what we're doing is you want to try to target certain fish tend to get along well with each other and do very well, and sometimes they don't.
Well, like it looks like some of my relatives, you know, like you got the mommy on one end of the fish tank and the daddy on the other, and they're all looking away. So is that what you mean? Sometimes they get along, they don't
get along. Sometimes they get along, they don't get along. And you really don't know exactly if they're ready to spawn yet or not. So if the female isn't ready, you know, basically they won't get along so well.
Like, go away. I've had enough of you.
Okay, yeah. I don't want to deal with you right now.
And so that's how you take one for one and put them in a tank like this?
One for one, scan it, put it in, you know which aquarium they're in, you know who's with who. And then, of course, you do record keeping to say, yeah, these guys made it, these guys didn't mate, things like that.
How old is this guy?
I'm not exactly sure. He's probably about three years old.
Is that old in fish terms?
Not particularly. Like these fish, they can actually grow to about 15 pounds.
Really?
If you let them, yeah. But of course, you want to keep them, you try to keep them a little bit smaller because then they take up less tank space, they're easier to handle, and things like that.
So I would say this is the male and that's the female?
Yeah. Yeah. In tilapia, typically the males grow bigger and larger than the females.
And how long are these two going to be in here while they're waiting to see whether or not there are any offspring?
We'll wait a couple weeks before we do it. Yeah.
You
right
got
now,
2 weeks, boys and girls.
Right now we put a divider in there.
Yeah.
And we put that divider in because most likely they weren't getting along very well yet. So, you know, and we don't want to just leave them alone. We want to be able to watch them when we do that. Because the male, being bigger than the female, he can actually kill the other fish.
These fish are carnivores?
Actually,
they're going to eat each other?
No, they would not eat each other. When they're in the adult stage where they're at right now, they're actually more omnivorous. So they can eat plants and vegetable material. So they in the wild, they could eat algae, they could eat, you know, other small things. They're not particularly a predatory fish.
Okay. Yeah. If you want to find out where you can get fresh tilapia, head out to the Independent in Ingersoll. Or Sean, where do I go to find frozen product?
You can find them in Tilsonburg at Tilsonburg Custom Foods.
Tilsonburg Custom Foods. And do you have to buy this amount?
No, I believe you can buy them in smaller quantities.
And really?
This is an 11-pound box. So
hang in there. We'll be right back with more innovation. There's somebody else that you wanted to introduce me to.
Yes, this is Roger. He's another manager here, and actually Roger,
good to meet
right
you.
On site. So
you live here.
Yeah, so Roger keeps an eye on all the.
So you keep an eye on all these poor fish here while they're breeding?
Most of every day.
Yeah, and what do you think they've got on their minds?
They're pretty focused on reproduction now.
Yeah, I guess. You'd have to be. But where do tilapia originate from?
They came from the Nile River. Gary Chapman started this approximately 20 years ago, a little bit better. He brought over the brood stock from directly from the Nile and started this up in Lindsay. So we're actually working with some of his brood stock here now. Helping him out / helping ourselves out. He's been working with the genetics, trying to develop a more marketable strain or a better growing strain of fish with pure melaticas directly from the Nile.
Do you think that Cleopatra dined on tilapia?
I couldn't say for sure, but I'm sure she must have tried them somewhere along the way.
Because they are the ones, they were the first fish farmers, weren't they?
Yes.
Yeah. I think she did.
It'd be a good assumption.
These are about 2 weeks old, and how they do it, the female lays its eggs, and then the male spawns, of course. She takes the eggs back up in her mouth, and that's where they stay until they hatch out. And she actually keeps them there for protection, of course, the water coming and going. And in the end, when they're big enough, then they come out, and there they are. We take the female out. And when we're doing the breeding process, we'll actually take the eggs out of her mouth and let them hatch, and then start them like this. But these are the smallest fish we have, and of course the biggest are the breeders.
Okay, from the time that they arrive here till the time they're going out your door to be shipped, how much time has transpired?
You're looking between 9 and 10 months if everything works the way it's supposed to.
And I guess you hope that everything
works
the way it's supposed
to. Yeah, and we're doing that, yes.
So this is now 2 weeks later, and they're really improved in size. And this is an automated feeder?
Yeah, it's just a timer, and that's very, very fine feed. They're actually just had a little taste there now. And these fish are probably 4 weeks old now, maybe five, almost 5 weeks old. So, and this is their biggest growth as far as doubling every so many almost days. That's how fast they're growing.
Now, in the wild, you know, this many fish wouldn't survive, sure. But here, 100% of them capable of surviving?
Pretty well, 100%. They give us 10% when we bring in the fish. So if there's 30,000 fish come in, they'd probably get around 3,000 extra for any mortality and shipping and everything. But they do very well at the shipping. These particular fish come out of New Mexico. We have no issues. Their bags come in about 1,500 in a bag, oxygen in it, and they do. Survival rate is wonderful, right through to market.
Stephanie, what's your job here?
I'm an aquaculture technician.
Do you go to school to learn how to be an aquaculture technician?
I actually went to University of Guelph and I took wildlife biology, so we did learn some aquaculture components, but I've pretty much learned mostly on the job.
So five families, each with their own set of genetics.
Yes.
You're interested in joining the family together to achieve
it. So we'll take the best from each family and cross them with another family and just see, again, the results. And for us, it's not just the color. It has to be economically viable, right? I mean, they have to survive. We have to have a high survival rate and a growth rate. If it takes them 2 years to reach size, I mean, that's not valuable in a market fish because we need to sell them. We can't invest years growing them up. So, you know, it's going to be a pretty long process just seeing. Again, you're selecting for traits, so you want that color, but you need the survival, you need the growth, you need the size. So it's trying to find the right combination of genetics.
Gotta admit, it's pretty amazing what you and your two other brothers have done here. Tell me about the risk and what you've had to sort of do over the time that this plant is being built.
Well, it's like any business. The startup is always, the banks all love you when it's running, making money, but nobody wants to talk to you when you're starting out. And of course, rightfully so, it does take time, it takes energy, and takes all the right people. So my brother Murray and brother Ed, they've kind of left me kind of the pinpoint of the thing and heading it up. But anyway, and anything goes wrong, it's always going to be my fault. But anyway, in the long run, it is a long journey to get here to where we are today. We're actually shipped last week 12,000 pounds, so we're pretty well to where we want to be. We feel good about it, all of us. So. It's been about 14 months. We've had people working here steady, but we're very happy with it, and I think it's going to be profitable.
Not yet profitable.
No, not yet, but we're just around the corner.
Just around the corner.
Yep.
Are all business people as optimistic as you are?
Well, they have to be, or they wouldn't be in business.
Yeah, right. You know, and that's what I mean by innovation. You've got to be able to have the money to spend the money, and you've got to be able to live for the uncertainty until you are making profit. That's really innovation. For Innovation Oxford, I'm Mike Harding. See you next time.
Thanks, Mike.